Good morning, everybody. It is good to see you this morning in this New Year's Eve. You could have been anywhere you wanted to be, but chose to worship, and I'm so grateful that you have come today. And I'm excited about what God is doing in our church and really excited about the next two-year initiative where we are going to grow deeper in our faith and our walk with Christ and try, and I'll define that word in a little while, try to become disciple makers, a church full of disciple makers. Now, this morning, sometimes when you get around the seasons and you get between Christmas and New Year's, it's kind of a lull where you're like, okay, waiting for the new year. You might be off work or whatever it is, and you're just kind of relaxing and enjoying it. And sometimes we treat worship that way. We treat, you know, the last day of the year. But I would challenge you to tune in and to kind of engage this morning with what God has for you in this message. However, I am going to do what is the obvious. There are two things that are obvious that we would preach on today. One is our resolutions, right? I wonder how many of us have said, I'm a little disgusted with the end of 2023, especially with my diet, whatever that was, and we're going into 2024. I got to change some things. And then the other thing that's obvious we're going to talk about is Jesus. So we're going to talk about the next year's resolutions and Jesus. But stay with me and turn to the book of Luke in chapter 2 if you have a Bible or app, or you can watch it on the screen, see the Bible verses. And we're going to talk about Jesus as a 12-year-old boy and see what God has for us for this next year by looking at Jesus at 12 years old. And here's the thought for today, another Captain Obvious. Jesus grew, so should you. Jesus grew, so should you. What does that mean? All right, let's analyze this for a moment. When we're talking about spiritual growth, let's imagine your spiritual maturity is visibly seen today. How many 50 to 60-year-olds would be on a pacifier? If we could see your spirituality, wouldn't that be hilarious? And sad at the same time. If we could see where your spiritual maturity is at the age that you are, and maybe not just the age, but the years that you have been serving the Lord, what would we see? Well, I'm a bit embarrassed about what you would see from me and how long I have been saved and what God has expected from me. However, there is a new year. 2023 is ending. In 2024, we would say, okay, well, we've got a chance in 2024 because we feel like that the year, a new year, is something different. It really isn't. It's just another day, isn't it? It's just another day you walk through, you go through, and then in another week, you're going to school. Students are going to school. We're going to work, something else. But tomorrow is another day, and it seems like there's something fresh, and there's an internal clock within us where at the end of the year, we're tired of it, and then it affects us mentally where we're ready for something new in another day. John Maxwell says that leaders should not focus on goals. Leaders should focus on growth. So when we're thinking about this fresh new start in the new year, and we're trying to set goals, and you should set goals for your life, but that should not be your focus. Because if we focus on our goals, it might not grow us. We say, okay, I want to go to church every Sunday next year, or I want to read my Bible every day next year. And those things are wonderful and fantastic. But the things that we do should result in growth in who we are. Because we are followers of Christ in 2023 and we want to be better followers of Christ in 2024, it is not setting the goals, it is just growing. I want to be better tomorrow than I am today. And what does that look like? What is your strategy for growing tomorrow? If you want to start fresh, start new, what is a strategy for growth? And I think we can find it in this passage where we grow like Jesus grew. grow with Christ, grow in Christ, walk with Christ. All of those things set in motion. Let's look at this passage and then see what God has for us. In verse 39, they got back from when Jesus was at the temple and when he was a baby, and it says, when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and favor of God was upon him. Jesus grew in wisdom and favor of God. Now I want you to churn that a little bit. Jesus, who is God, came to earth to be the Son of God, grew. What did that look like? And then shows where he's 12 years old. This is the only passage that we see where Jesus was a young boy. Now, his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the Feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up according to custom. And when the feast was ended, as they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it. But supposing him to be in a group, they went a day's journey, but then they began to search for him among their relatives and acquaintances. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress." They were a little upset, which is probably warranted for them being the parents and him being out for 3 days. And he said to them, "Why are you looking for me? Do you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" And they did not understand the saying that he spoke to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth, but was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. God grew. That don't make sense. But in this passage, let's just start with this, where Jesus is 12 years old and he goes through and then he's at the temple and he stays there, and for 3 days his parents are looking for him. And when they get back, they were upset. I remember a day when Alicia texted me and let me know about Sarah, our oldest, when she was really young and was at Toys R Us, and she got lost in Toys R Us. Well, she wasn't lost. We lost her. It was one of those occasions where she saw a toy and went after it, Alicia went to the front of the store and said, "I can't find my daughter." They shut the store down, and all the workers went and searched for her. And when they found her, it was a relief that, you know, parents, what it's like, that if you thought that your child was lost or gone, there is a sense about you that you have lost part of yourself. And so that's where Mary and Joseph's emotions are. And then they come to Jesus, and Jesus says, "No, I was in the place I was supposed to be." And at 12 years old, the Bible says, in sandwiched between his birth and then 12 years old, it says, Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. What does that mean, and what would that look like for us? Let's first look at what it looks like for Jesus to grow. If we're going to grow, we have to know him first. So what does it look like for Jesus to grow? It means this, that Jesus, who was God, and he was God forever. He's always been God. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Jesus is God, but he decided, because of the sins of the world, that he would become human flesh. And so the God of the universe, who created everything, has become human and became a baby so that he could live this earth as a human and grow and cry and have bad diapers and have to be raised. Where if Mary and Joseph didn't raise him, or if somebody didn't raise him, he could have died as a child. as a baby. Imagine that God put himself in the hands of humans as a human. And what an amazing passage this is to see. And many scholars have often argued this thought of, when did Jesus know that he was divine? I mean, when was the moment in which Jesus became the Messiah? And we can't answer that totally, but we do know this, that Jesus had to figure out his life and grow in the wisdom of Christ, of the Father, and in his own skin. As he was growing, you notice in this text, we notice also that as he was growing, he was, as Dr. Dick Lincoln said in the last service, that he was remarkable. It means that Jesus was more than just an average child. He had something more about him that people saw that was pretty amazing. So he went into the temple and he astonished everybody and what they had said. And then he said this thing, and here's what I want you to grab. I want you to grab hold of this as we're going to get into ourselves. I want you to think about that Jesus switched. He switched his mentality from being the child of Joseph and Mary to now being the child of Heavenly Father. This is where he realized that there was something more about himself. And he is, yes, he was under submission. In the text it says that he was under the submission of Mary and Joseph, and he submitted to them. But this was a moment where he says, I am now under the submission or under the authority of the Father. I'm going to do what God tells me to do. So he made that choice, and then the Bible says he grew in wisdom and in stature. When we're thinking about Jesus, we really sometimes think about when it relates to us and our spirituality and our Christianity, we often think about, well, we've got to do what Jesus did. And if we do what Jesus did, he will show us how to be godly, or he'll show us what God looks like. But Jesus, listen to this statement. Jesus did not come to show us how to be God. Jesus came to show us how to be human. Jesus did not come to show us how to be God. Jesus came to show us how to be human, the best human. And when he's showing us how to be human, he's not only showing us how to be human, but he's also dying for our sins as a human so that we don't have to make the trek ourselves. He puts his life within us so that we can begin to live a Christ-like life. We can now become the human God wanted us to be. Now, I want you to grab this before we go on to this second part. And stick with me, because this is incredible stuff, where Jesus came to show us how to be human, but he also came to die for our sins so that he could give himself to us so that it could be possible that we could be the humans we're supposed to be, Christ-like humans. All right, that may be confusing, but let's move on further. In this text, if we're going to grow, we are going to have to know Jesus as our Lord and Savior, as the human that he was who died for our sins, and as the God who raised again on the third day. You need to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's the very first thing. Some of you may have not done that, and in 2023, the last thing that you do in 2023 could be the best thing that you've ever done in your life, where you trust Jesus Christ to be your Savior and you give him your life. Jesus, who died for your sins, and now he gives you the power to become the person you were supposed to be, and to take the sins that you have had in your life and to wash them clean and to become new. Now, here's the second thing. This is the second thing. If we're going to grow, we have to know Jesus. But also, secondly, if we're going to grow, we have to walk with Christ. There has to be an experience where you walk with Christ. If Jesus grew, if he had an experience where he grew, we have to grow too. Let me give you an illustration. Let's just say you've got an iPhone. I've got one right here. And if you have an Android, that's fine too. Whatever you got, a device that you can look at, and you got apps in there. You can put the YouVersion Bible app and begin reading with us every week and every day. You've got things on your phone, and here it is. When you buy it from the store, you don't expect it to grow. You expect it to do what it says it's going to do when you buy it. If I get this phone home and it ain't making calls, and I call Verizon or I call Apple and I say, hey, my phone is not working. It's not making calls. Well, give it a day or two, it'll grow into it. Get my phone back. Fix it. There's an expectation, right? There's an expectation of some things that we have that if we buy a car, I don't expect my car to grow into being a good car. It better be good when I buy it, or I've wasted my money. But there are other things that have to grow. Plants have to grow. Information sometimes has to grow in our minds. And we have to grow. And spiritually, we have to grow, which means this. When you trust Jesus Christ to be your Savior, you can't be an iPhone. You can't have all the knowledge. You can't be all spiritual. There's going to have to be a process of growth that happens in your life. That's why we're doing deeper, and that's why that we talk about it all the time, that once you are a follower of Christ, it doesn't mean you've reached the pinnacle of your spirituality. You're just getting started. That's why we need the church, and that's why we need reading our Bibles. That's why we need groups, and that's why we need all of the spiritual things, not so that we can become righteous, but so that we can grow in our righteousness. You're righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ, but you can grow in your righteousness and grow in your faith by doing the things and walking with Christ. So what does it mean to walk with Christ? What did it mean in the experience? Look at this text. It says, and Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. But then you notice as a 12-year-old boy, he went away from his parents. He was in the temple. Yes, he amazed them, but he ate and he slept and he walked. And as he grew older, the Bible says that he had nowhere to lay his head. And everything that Jesus did was human. He emptied himself of his divine nature totally, so that he could be totally human and experience life just like us. And so this is how he grew. He grew as a human grows, even spiritually. Now, it didn't mean he sinned. No, that's on us. That's why Jesus came, was to deliver us from sin. He didn't grow as from a sinner to a better saint. No, what it means is he completed his purpose on earth. We're walking with Jesus to complete our purpose, but the thing that we've got to realize is that as a human, we are experiencing life and growing in Christ as a human grows in Christ. It means you don't look for every divine thing around the corner to make you grow in Christ. You just go to work. You come home, do the dishes, cook the food, watch TV, go to bed, get up, go to school, hang out with friends. Just be a human, right? It means every single day. This is not an experience where you're trying to find that divine God writing everything on the wall and I'm a better Christian because God has given me some kind of epiphany. No, I'm better today than I was yesterday because I walked with God as a human today. I walked with God when I lost something. I walked with God as a human when I lost my job or when I got a job. I walked with God as a human when I lost a friend or I found a friend. Walking with Jesus in 2024, what would it look like? What would the strategy look like in walking with Jesus in 2024? It would look like just live your day every day, listen to this, with Jesus supreme in your life. Here's the only thing Jesus did. This is it. When he talked about it when he was an adult. I must be about my Father's business. I've got to be at my Father's house. It's all about the Father and the Father's will. Here's how you live your life. You live your life each and every day with human experiences saying yes to Jesus. This is simple. I know it's obvious. It's so obvious that we might get lost in it. But it's so profound that Jesus has given us a simple way of growing in him and being the person he has made us to be. And that is every single day, get up and start walking with Jesus and saying yes to Jesus every single day. If you miss a day, wake up the next day saying, I didn't say yes to you yesterday and it was a bad day. Today I say yes, yes to Jesus. It starts with salvation. There's a first time where you have said yes to Jesus in his forgiveness of sins, but there is a daily walk. It's called sanctification, where you daily walk with Jesus every single day. It's also an ongoing experience. It means that you're going to do this for the rest of your life. You're going to fail and you're going to succeed. Jesus kept growing. The Bible says as a baby, he grew. As a 12-year-old, he grew. He just kept on growing. And the same goes with us, with Christ in our lives. We begin to grow. It is an ongoing experience. You're not going to stop. You're not going to end. There's not going to be a place where you say, I made it to church all year. I'm awesome. This is fantastic. My spiritual life is at the pinnacle. It can't get any better. That's a lie. It can get a lot better. Our life is a continual, ongoing experience. Why? Because there are human experiences that we have that's going to need the ongoing experience with Christ. I'm going to face something tomorrow, probably that I've never faced. Could be. And I'm going to need to walk with Jesus to help me get through that ongoing experience. It's an ongoing thing. It is ongoing. And here's where I want, especially teenagers, young people, listen to this really carefully. Students, now we all need to listen to this, but especially younger, get this idea in your head. Just continually get this in your head. Don't try to be anything more than what God has put you, the place that he's put you today. Don't try to be anything more or be anywhere beyond where God has placed you today. When I was 25, I wanted to have the wisdom of a 70-year-old. You know what my dad said? He said, don't try to do that. It'll make you old. Just be 25. Experience life at 15, at 12. At 18, at 20, 25, 30, 35. Experience life in the moment where you're at. Don't try to be anything more than what you are. And here's the thing is God will begin to show you things in the moments where you're at that will be way beyond what you could try to get by yourself. I do remember when I was 8 years old, I preached my first sermon at 8 years old. It was bad. It was really bad. My theology was bad. I had terrible theology. I preached on Noah and the flood, and the theology was so bad that my father said that you shouldn't preach that sermon again. Let's work on that. Now, that was 8 years old. What would you expect, right? I'd learned the things, but as a follower of Christ at 8 years old, wanting to preach, that's what it was. I began to grow. Thank God I'm not preaching like I was at eight at 46. I think what happens in 2024 is that January 1st, tomorrow, just begin to walk with Christ tomorrow, and then the 2nd, and then the 3rd, and then the 4th, and the 5th. And by December 31st of next year, you will find a remarkable improvement in who you are. Don't try to be anything more than what you're. Jesus did not try to die on a cross at 12. He wasn't ready. The world wasn't ready for him to die on a cross. Can you imagine the outrage of a 12-year-old dying on a cross? It wouldn't have brought the same results. Jesus had to grow, and so do you and I. There's also here, not only human and ongoing, but there's a divine experience that takes place. There are moments in which, while you're walking with Christ, something divine happens. Something happens that you can't explain, that can only be explained by God. Jesus was in the temple, and he began to talk to the Pharisees, the Pharisees and all the people of the temple, and they began to be astonished by his questions and all that he did. And that was something that wasn't just him. That was something that God had given to him. And he grew in wisdom and in stature. Something divine is going to happen. And it's not going to be that you're going to walk on water or perform miracles, or it couldn't, not that the right guy is going to come your way, or the right girl, or whatever it may be. You're going to have an amazing retirement. I'm not talking about those things. I'm talking about where God will show up in your daily walk to give you comfort for the day, to give you wisdom for the day. It will be amazing. Students, it will be amazing to see the wisdom that comes out of you when you walk with the Lord. The things that you will be able to do, you'll think, my, God has done something special. You go through something rough, something terrible, and you're able to handle it through the grace of God and the wisdom of God. As you go through 2024, you don't know what's going to happen. But as it happens, and God gives you the grace and the strength to go through it, and you wake up saying, Jesus showed himself to me. He walked with me through the struggle. The decisions that you have to make. Some of you are maybe graduating high school or college, or you're trying to think about a career, or you're thinking about retirement. You're thinking about the next phase of life, the next season of life, and you're wondering, I've got to make the decision in 2024. What will set me up best to make the best decision in 2024? Walk with Jesus. Walk with Jesus. Now, what does that look like practically? What it looks like practically for us is, number one, we have to have a personal walk. And that means getting into Bible reading. Read your Bible. And next Sunday will help us give something that will be kind of like a motivator through the Bible app, YouVersion Bible app. Get into a group. You can't do it alone. You need other people around you to be able to. Jesus had 12 disciples. You should have people around you. Get in a group. Make a habit of Jesus. I've always thought this and said this, and it's always been something to me. The more you read the Bible, it's God talking to you, right? The more you read the Bible, the more you're going to think like God thinks. The more you're going to understand and begin to make decisions like God makes, would want you to make. You become the human God has created for you to be. Just in reading the Bible and understand that's not even talking about the spiritual stuff. It's you read the Bible as a follower of Christ. Christ will speak to you and show you things in there that is important. So, this is an obvious day, New Year's Eve, with an obvious subject, New Year's resolutions. What's your strategy for 2024? And an obvious subject about Jesus. But the question is this morning, what is going to be your strategy? And this is the decision making. Number one, have you trusted Jesus Christ for your salvation? Is that going to be something that you want to have happen to you for 2024 and the rest of your life? Where Jesus can save you and he can give you a home, and that when, if 2024 is your last year, you have another place to go in heaven. Followers of Christ, you need to grow. You need to grow in your faith. It makes a difference in your personal life. It makes a difference in the world around you. You need to grow. So what is your strategy? Will you grow as Christ grew? Meaning this, will you just take the next step and say yes to Jesus? Whatever it is, if he says, I want you to be faithful, yes, Jesus. I want you to be faithful to your family. Yes, Jesus, I will do that. And I want you to read your Bible. Yes, I will do that. And saying yes to Jesus, but not in your own energy, saying yes to Jesus because Jesus is living in you and giving you the motivation to move forward in that. God, I want to make the good decisions. I want to make the right decisions. Help me to be what you want me to be at school and at work, just saying yes to Jesus. So that is the invitation. I'm going to pray, and then you have an opportunity if you want to come down to speak with me or just come to the altar and just say, for 2024, God, help me just to continually every day say yes to you. Help me say yes today. We'll think about tomorrow. But today, the answer is yes. I want you to be the Lord of my life. Heavenly Father, we're grateful this morning for what you've done for us and who you are. God, I pray that you would help us just to say yes to you. And I know, God, this is one of those days where we're trying to turn over new leaves, but may it be that we're just, for the next 12 months and beyond, every single day, living for you. And then see the results when it's over. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.